Good morning. Let's continue with our sessions on distribution systems. This is Professor Uma Rao from RV College of Engineering, bringing you the lectures on transmission and distribution under the aegis of VTU eSikshana program. So in the last class, we had seen the difference between feeders and distributors. And we saw in detail the radial feeder and the parallel feeder. So the radial feeders, the issue is that if a fault occurs, number of customers will get affected because there is only one path to every customer. And however, it is very simple and cheap compared to others, and so it is quite popular. And in parallel feeders, we have two parallel paths, maybe supplied from the same substation or different substations. And so there is an alternate route in case a fault occurs. But however, I had mentioned that we have to take care about the sizing of the equipment. And keep in mind that if a fault occurs, then one of the feeders will have to take the entire load. Okay, so improper design may lead to a futile experience where even if you have a path, the path may trip. And the second point we have to keep in mind is the protection settings. So we have to set it for the worst cases, not for the best case. So we will proceed with that. So next we have ring main feeders. We already saw what is the meaning of a ring main feeder. So you start from a point and you go in a loop. Okay, you go in a loop. Now you just look at, I want to draw your attention to this figure. So this is the source. This is the source end. Here you have the source. And so you see, if you go around, you go in a loop. And you can see here, there are some connectors, sectionalizers, they're called. They divide the line into sections. So you see here, there, it's like a, you think of it like a switch. So if I close this, then there is a path to this from here. See, if I close this and this, if I close, then to this load, there is a path here. So if I leave this open, then the path, there is no path from the other side. Okay. So if I take this section, for example, I want this load, right, to be fed from this path. Let us call this as path one and path two. Supposing I want this load to be fed through path one, then I will be closing all these. These sectionalizers will be closed and I will open this. This will be open. So the path to this will be like this. Clear? Now, if there's a fault here, then this will get interrupted. So what I can do, this anyway becomes open. That time I close this and then there will be an alternate path through this. Right? So you can see that a ring main definitely improves reliability. However, the cost is high because not only providing for the distributors, but I also have to provide for the sectionalizers, switches, and so on. Protection will be slightly more complicated. And as I told you, when we design the protection system, we have to keep in mind the selectivity and sensitivity of the protection system. Okay. So the primaries of distribution transformers, they form a loop. The loop circuit starts from the substation bus bars, makes a loop through to the area to be served, and returns to the substation. That's why it's called as a loop. An entire loop is formed. So if fault occurs at any section of the feeder, then the faulted section of the feeder can be isolated anywhere, wherever there's a fault. And till, you know, such time that it gets repaired. So, and you can maintain the continuity of supply to the other consumers. That's the advantage. So there are less voltage fluctuations at the consumer terminals. because a path is always ensured. System is reliable because each distributor is fed via two feeders. And improved voltage regulation, because you can choose whichever path will give you the least drop that can be chosen. I have sectionalizers in between. I can switch on and off and reduce losses. And however, the main disadvantage is expensive. So I told you, nothing comes free. You know, you want quality, you have to pay money. You want reliability, you have to pay money. Next, we have interconnected systems. So here the feeder ring is energized by two or more than two sources, and it is called as an interconnected system. This improves reliability since it supplies power to all the distribution transformers, even though some part of the network is out of order. See here, this is better than the radial system, sorry, better than the ring system, because in the ring system, you have only one substation and it goes in a loop. Here you are energized by more than one station. So you're energized by two stations. So even if there is a fault in the station and the station itself is shut down, still you can supply your consumer. So the redundancy is more. Your power source itself is redundant, but it's very expensive. Okay. And you may go in for an interconnected system provided your load is critical. For example, a hospital, let us say. You know, a hospital, yes, it's a critical load. So you may want to connect it through from two substations. You might want to give an option. Or let us say our transportation, electric transportation, like metro. Then yes, I can't rely only on one substation, because if that substation there's a problem or down for scheduled maintenance, I don't have any other source. So in such cases, we may resort to interconnected systems. It's always good to have the supply from more than one source. Clear? Because the load is critical. And it's worth the expense when the load is critical. So you just see here, I have substation one and substation two. When both are operating, and if there's a fault in any of these feeder sections, then we, by suitably opening and closing, we can provide alternate paths. So if there's a fault in any of the substation itself, still the other substation can feed all the loads, provided there is capacity. So this is one, and this is taken from the electrical engineering portal. This is another. So I have source one and source two, and then these are the feeders. And from the feeder, I have distributors running and distributors. These are radial here. So you can have different combinations. Clear? So that is the advantage of the interconnected system. So it vastly increases the service reliability. And any area fed from one generating station during peak load hours can be fed from the other generating stations if there is a peak load. Okay. So you by proper design, you can reduce the reserve on the system. What is the meaning of reserve? Reserve is that extra capacity I have. Say, supposing my load is 200 megawatts, then I'll have a capacity of 250 megawatts. So that 50 megawatts is reserved. I don't use it most of the time. I may only use it during peak hours, but it's a waste, because it's just like keeping a car in your garage and just taking it out once in a month or so. It's a waste, right? So it's a waste of capital investment. So if I can reduce the reserve, then my investment can come down. Okay. So by properly planning, we can reduce the investment. So these are the primary distributions. Now let's come to the secondary. Secondary is where you step it down to still lower voltages. In India, it is 415 volts. And give it to local supply. Mostly it will be residential and maybe commercial, but not industrial. Industrial will need a higher voltage. So what are the popular configurations I have here? I have a three-phase three-wire and three-phase four-wire. So three-phase three-wire you can use for balanced loads, like a three-phase induction motor. But three-phase four-wire you can use for unbalanced loads. Clear? So you can also have single-phase two-wire system. But since our generation is all three-phase, So we don't generate at single phase. Three phase, four wire is very popular, and all your single phase loads you can supply between the line and neutral of your three phase four wire system. So normally in India, the standard is 415 volts, and that is the line to line voltage, and the line to neutral voltage is 230 volts, that is 415 by root 3. Clear? So this is called as a secondary distribution. So three phase distribution, you have substations are constructed at the load centers where you want to supply the load. And they have, you have the necessary switch gear, bus bars, fuses, and voltage is stepped down to the consumer level, which is 415 volts. Your local transformer also, you can actually call it as a substation because it will step it down from 11 kV to 415 volts. And three phases, you know, internationally it is R, Y, B, the three lines. And most of the commercial establishment, like say malls, hospitals, all, you know, they will all take three phase because they'll be operating pumps, escalators, elevators, three phase ACs, and so on. And 230 volts is normally used for all single phase loads and lighting loads. So most of the domestic consumers would be using 230 volts phase to neutral. So three phase three wire connection consists of three wires, RYB, and for a four wire, you have a fourth conductor called the neutral, which is a neutral conductor. And you know from basic electrical engineering that the neutral current is equal to IR plus IY plus IB. IR plus IY plus IB. So under balanced conditions, these three will be balanced, and therefore neutral current will be zero. If there is any unbalance, the neutral current will flow. So this is a typical illustration. So you see, I have my incoming transformer. You can call this as the distribution substation, right? And I have three wires, RYB here. So my three phase load is connected there. You might have a motor, a big motor, or if it's a commercial establishment, there are lifts, elevators, escalators, all those, will be three phase centralized AC. And and between any line and neutral, they can connect single phase loads. So you see here, some part of the load is connected between R and N, some part between Y and N, and some part between B and N. So let us say it's a huge mall. So maybe the lighting load of the first three floors is connected between R and N, and the next three floors between Y and N, and the next three between B and N, and so on. So now you can see where the unbalance will come here, because all the three loads may not be equal. I may distribute it equally, but when I'm using it, the usage may not be balanced. Clear? See, just to give you an example, I may connect 100 lights to all the three phases between R and Y and B and 100, 100, 100. So I am assuming that I have given balanced load. Yes, but then the first three floors, they may shut off at around 5 o'clock or 6 p.m. in the evening. There may be offices, so they close at 6 p.m. Okay, and in the top floor, normally we have restaurants which may operate till midnight. So when these people switch off the lights, they will be putting it on. So yes, all of them I have connected 100 lights, but each one uses it at a different time. So unbalance will be there. So some amount of neutral conductor will flow. Okay, neutral current will flow in the neutral conductor. Clear? So I think we are clear about what is three wire and what is four wire. Lighting and other single phase loads are connected between a phase and neutral. And large air conditioners, motors, etc. are connected between the three lines, three phase load. Normally, industries and commercial sectors are provided with three-phase power to connect heavy machinery and equipment, and domestic consumers are normally given a single phase. Single-phase two-wire system, this type of distribution is employed to supply power to domestic loads. So you will have between the line and the neutral. The load will be connected between the line and the neutral. They are connected to single phase and neutral at the substation bus bars, right? So we call it a single phase, but it's not a single phase generation. It's between the line and neutral of the three phase system. So we got some idea now about the different kinds of connections. So now let's come to distributors. So what is a distributor? A distributor is a conductor where you have tappings in between. So loads will be supplied by tapping in between. That is a distributor. So the two main issues in the distributor are, how do I specify the load? Clear? Normally we specify it as a concentrated load. That means I connect a fan, it is concentrated at this point. You model it as a concentrated load. A distributed load is where I will say it takes so many watts per kilometer or so many kilowatts per kilometer. That is, it is distributed. For example, you may be supplying some street lighting or something like that. So instead of, I can't show it as number of concentrated, I may break it into sections and say this is the load. It's just a type of modeling to account for current distribution. We will see that when we do the problems. So how to specify the load? So do we specify it as a concentrated load or as a distributed load? And how do I specify the power factor? With respect to the receiving, power factor is what? Angle between voltage and current, right? So one way of doing it is one voltage. Normally the receiving end voltage is specified as the reference. And all parameters, all other voltages, currents, etc., they're all referred with respect to the receiving end voltage. Clear? So if I have a current at one part of the network, I'll give an angle. That angle would be with respect to the receiving end voltage angle. So that is called as referring the power factor with respect to VR. VR is the receiving end voltage. But normally if I connect a motor, right? And I say the power factor of the motor is 0.85. What do I mean by that? When I say a motor is connected and its power factor is 0.85, what do I mean by that? Obviously, what I mean is the current drawn by the motor will lag the voltage across the motor. And the power factor is 0.85. So the angle of lag will be cos inverse of 0.85. Right? So normally equipment power factors are specified between the voltage and current of the equipment. Are you understanding that point? So I have connected a motor here. There is no point in specifying the angle of the current with respect to voltage at some receiving end somewhere. But yes, for calculations, this is also another way of doing it. So practically, when you buy an equipment, remember the power factor is always between the voltage and current. Which voltage? The voltage where you're going to connect the load. That's the correct practice. So these are the two issues. We will take it up. Yeah. So first, power factor with respect to receiving end voltage. So let me take a simple radial distributor. So this is my source. So you see the arrow of the current. And I have a load here, I1, drawing a current I1 at a power factor cos phi 1 and I2 at a power factor cos phi 2. I2 at a power factor of cos phi 2. Okay. So the current flowing here is I2, you can see here, and the current flowing here is I1. and this current, sorry, here it is I1 plus I2, because this is I1, this is I2. So here it is I1 plus I2, and that is the source current. That is the source current. So I want you to understand very clearly. Normally, when I specify the load, this cos phi 1 would represent the angle. This phi 1 would represent the angle between this current I1 and the voltage at point Y. So if, let us say this is a motor, right? So if I say this is a motor, say a 15 amps motor with a power factor of 0.85, what I mean is this current is 15 amps, and this 0.85 power factor is with respect to voltage at Y, right? But now in distribution system, this is also a common way of specifying. So here this cos phi 1 refers to, here the phi 1 refers to the angle between receiving end voltage, the farthest receiving end. Here, this at Z, this is the farthest point from the source. This is also a receiving end only. Y also, farthest receiving end, and the current. Are you clear? So I1 is the angle between, sorry, phi 1 is the angle between I1 and VZ, which is VR. This is called as receiving end voltage VR. Similarly, phi 2 is the angle between I2 and VZ. So now let's draw the phasor diagram. Just like how I told you in module 3, don't memorize the phasor diagram. Please don't memorize the phasor diagram. It's very easy to draw it, provided you know how to draw it step by step. So let's just take, this is I1. Okay. This is I2. Simply I've taken phi1 and phi some angle. And this is IS. That is I1 plus I2. So you can start from here. Let's start from VR. We always start from VR. This is VR. Okay. Now, just look at this angle. Phi2 is this angle between VR and I2 is Phi2. And between VR and I1 is Phi1. So you can draw this. Right? You can easily draw it. Between VR and I1 is Phi1. Right? So draw VR, I1 and I2. So I1 at an angle of Phi1 with respect to VR, I2 at an angle of Phi2 with respect to VR, and find out the source current, which is I1 plus I2. No problem. Next, I need to find the voltages. So VR is nothing but VZ. So I have to add the drop in this section. Add the drop in section YZ. Right. So what is the drop? The drop here will be I2 R2. So I2 R2 will be in phase with I2. So you see this is I2. So I2 R2 is in phase with I2. And I2 X2 leads by 90 degrees. And so this is VY. This is VY. Got it? Next, I need VX. So VX will be VY plus drop in this section. What is the drop in this section? IS R1. Plus JIS X1. So I have VI, IS R1. So you see this is in phase with IS, and IS X1 leads, and then I have VX. Then I have VX. Got it? So let's just quickly draw again. I'm just erasing and showing you again how to draw, because students are normally very confused about this. And I find a whole lot of students trying to memorize. So let's do with a different color now. Yeah. So how do I start off? VR, which is VZ, I draw that. Then I draw I2 at an angle of phi 2 with respect to VR. and I1 at an angle of phi 1 with respect to VR, right? Then I calculate IS. IS is the sum of I1 and I2. Next, I2 R2 in phase with I2, and then I2 X2, I get VY. Then IS R1, IS R2, X1, I get VX. That is a sending end voltage. Simple. Yes. So no memorization required. It can be drawn. Now let's see power factor with reference to respective load voltages. What is that respective load voltages means? This is phi 1 is angle between I1 and VY, and phi 2 is angle between I2 and VZ. So I can't draw I1 unless I know VY, because I have to draw I1 with respect to VY. So the steps here are slightly different. There, I drew VR and I drew I1 and I2. Okay, now we'll see how to do it. So same way, I'll draw VR, start with VR. You can make it horizontal too, no problem. And this is I2. I2. Okay. So this I2 is drawn at an angle of phi 2 with respect to VR. Next, draw I2 R2, I2 X2, and you get VY. I get VY. Only after you get VY, you can draw I1. Not before that. So now I1 is drawn at an angle of phi 1 with respect to VY, because here my power factor angles are with respect to the load voltages. Then once you draw that, finished. Then it's easy. Once I draw I1, then I calculate, I draw IS, and then this is IS R1, IS X1, and VX. Got it? Simple, right? So let's draw it again to remind ourselves how to draw. Okay. So yeah. So what do we do? Start with VR. Draw I2 at an angle of phi 2, then I2 R2, I2 X2, draw VY, then draw I1 at an angle of phi 1 with respect to VY, and then find out IS, and then you have IS R1, IS X1, and then you have VX. Done. Clear? It won't give you too much of a difference in the results. But anyway, these are the two ways normally the power factor is specified. Yeah. So now let us try to do some problems. And how do we solve them? We'll just see. So a two-wire feeder, two-wire means single phase, XYZ, has a load of 100 amperes at Z and of 50 amperes at Y, both at a PF of 0.8 lag with respect to the receiving end voltage. So what are all important here? Of course, the receiving end current that is 100 amperes at Z and 50 amperes at point Y. And PF is 0.8 PF lag with respect to receiving end voltage. The impedance of section XY is 0.03 plus J 0.06 ohms. And YZ is 0.06 plus J 0.1 ohm. And voltage at the far end Z is maintained at 100. So here at Z, at 400, sorry. At Z, we need to maintain it at 400 volts. Find the voltage at X and Y. So the resistance is given, impedances are given. If nothing is told, we'll use that only. But if it's a single phase two wire system, then you may have to double it. I've told you that, because in a single phase two wire, the the return and forward and return conductor. You'll have two conductors. Whereas in the three phase, the neutral current is very small. We saw that. So you, anyway, so let's assume that it is the entire loop impedance. So this is my figure. So always, whenever you solve, first draw the figure correctly with the data given. So what's the data given? Section XY, YZ, right? Their impedances and the load at Y, the load at Z and the voltage at Z. So the first step is to draw the figure correctly. Next, I have drawn the figure again here for your reference. Now, impedance of section XY is this. Given, this is the data given. Impedance of section YZ is this. So let's consider VZ as the reference phasor. So it is 400 volts. So I will make it as plus J0. Why? Reference phasor, I am taking the angle as 0 degrees. So in my phasor diagram, all the phasors are represented with respect to VZ. Okay, fine. Now the current through section YZ here. What is the current here? It is obviously I2, right? So I2 is given 100. Power factor is 0.8. So cos phi is 0.8 means sine phi is 0.6. And why this minus? Anybody? The minus is because it is lagging load. Okay. So the current through section YZ is 100. Into 0.8 minus J0.6, which is 80 minus J60 amperes. And the current through section XY here, it would be I1 plus I2. So I1 I already know. And I2 is 50 amperes. And that's also at a power factor of 0.8. So I have 0.8 minus J0.6 because it's also lagging. So this is the first term, this is the second term. So my total current is 120 plus J90 amperes. See, most of what we will be doing in this distribution is your first year, first semester, basic electrical engineering. Those problems, simple, KCL, KVL, that's all you'll be applying here. Nothing very complicated. Next, the voltage drop in section YZ is the current. Current is I2, 80 minus J60 into impedance. Okay. So I have shown all the steps so that you don't make mistakes when you calculate. So convert this into rectangular, from rectangular to polar, this also into polar. Then I multiply the two magnitudes. I get 11.6 and I add the two angles and I get the angle. So this is added. The two angles are added and the magnitudes are multiplied. So I get voltage drop in section YZ is this. Here. Next, voltage drop in section XY. I'm drawing the same figure again and again just to relate. That's all. So the current here is, of course, I1 plus I2 into Z1. So I1 plus I2, we have already found out, it's 120 minus J90 into Z1. So I get the drop in section XY, right? Now, what is the voltage at VY? The voltage at VY will be VZ in VZ, that is a voltage in ZZ, plus the voltage drop in section YZ. So VZ plus VYZ. VYZ is I2 into Z2. That is the impedance of section YZ, which we already found out. You know, this I2 into Z2, we have already found out here. We have here 10.74 plus J4.37. So I get the voltage at Y. It is 410.76 at an angle of 0.609 volts. So this angle is with respect to, can you complete the statement? this angle is with respect to VZ. Okay, VZ is zero. Next, voltage at supply end, X. So that will be VY plus I1 plus I2 into Z1. I1 plus I2 into Z1, I have already found out. So it is this, I get the source voltage is 418.87 at an angle of 1.147 degrees. So if you look at the magnitude, can you tell the regulation? Regulation from sending end to the extreme receiving end, 480 minus 400 by 400. Okay. So there is a drop of around 18 volts along the distribute. Let's take up one more example. A single phase AC distributor, 300 meters long, has a total impedance of 0.04 plus j 0.08 ohms. And it is fed from one end at 200 volts. So the sending end voltage is 200 volts. It is loaded as follows. 60 amperes UPF at 150 meters from feeding point. 120 amperes 0.8 PF lag 200 meters from feeding point, and 60 amps 0.6 PF lag at the far end. Determine the voltage at the far end of the distributor. Yeah. So first draw the figure correctly. So this is my feeding end. So this voltage is 200. So I have at 150 meters from the feeding end, I have 60 amperes UPF. Then at 200 meters, that means from here to here would be 50 meters, I have 120 amperes, 0.8 PF. And at the far end, so the total length is 300. So this is already 200. So this has to be 100. It is 60 amperes at 0.6 PF lag. So this is what you have to draw first. Now, what will you do? What will you do? Start off with the impedances of all the three sections. You have to find the total impedance is this. So this is the impedance for 300 meters. So for the respective lengths, you have to find the impedance. And then from here, if I take this as the reference, then I have to keep subtracting the drops at the three, and then I have to find the voltage at the receiving end. Clear? But normally I told you that the power factor is with respect to the receiving end. So let's see what we are going to do. So impedance of the total section is 0.04 plus j 0.08. so section AB is 150 meters. So I multiply by 150 by 300. I get the impedance of section AB, that is nearest to the feeding end. Then section BC is 50 meters. And I get the impedance for section BC. Then section CD is 100 meters. So I get the impedance for section CD. Clear? Now, assuming all power factors are with respect to far end voltage VD, I've given you, one is at point, one is at UPF, one is at 0.8, one is at 0.6 PF. So PF with respect to what? We will assume that we will solve the problem assuming it's all with respect to VD. Right? Fine. So I1 is 60 at UPF. So it is 60 into 1 minus J0. I2 is 120 at 0.8 lag. So cos phi is 0.8. Sin phi will be 0.6. Then I3 is 60 at 0.6. So cos phi is 0.6. So sin phi will be 0.8. I get the three currents. I have the three impedances and the three currents. Now, let the voltage at the load point be D. VD equal to V plus J zero. I'm taking this as the reference. So angle is zero. That is indicated by the imaginary part being zero. Sine zero will be zero. So plus J zero. Okay. So total voltage drop in the distributor, what will it be? As I told you, it's simple network theory. Let's apply network theory, right? So this is I3. So I3 into Z3, here it is I3. So I3 into Z3, then the current here it will be I2 plus I3. So I2 plus I3 into Z2, and the current here, it will be I1 plus I2 plus I3, right? So nothing, no power systems involved. It is simple network theory. So the total voltage drop in the distributor is I1 plus I2 plus I3 into Z1 plus I2 plus I3 into Z2 plus I3 into Z3. I have put the detailed calculation here so that you will know how to do it correctly. So this is I1 plus I2 plus I3, and this is Z1, and this is I2 plus I3, and this is Z2, and this is I3, and this is Z3. Right? You have to add. Before that, you have to multiply. So for multiplication, I have converted all of them into polar and then multiplied, and then again converted back to rectangular and then add. But some calculators will do it directly. You can directly add, multiply in either polar or rectangular form. You can use it. Okay, fine. So what is important is this. Finally, the total voltage drop is 12.82 at an angle of 27.07. This angle is with respect to what? It is with respect to VD. That is my reference. VD, I have taken it to be at 0 degrees. Clear? So now I can write voltage at the sending end is voltage at far end plus voltage drop in distributor. Voltage drop in distributor is this. This is with respect to VD, angle with respect to VD. So voltage at the far end is just VD. Imaginary part is zero because the angle is zero. And voltage drop in the distributor, I know. I do this. And what is the voltage at the sending end? It is 200. Sending end is given. Voltage is 200. So 200 is equal to, I'm only given the magnitude. So I have to find the magnitude of the receiving end voltage. What is this? It will be VD plus 11.416 square. This is the real part. Real part square plus imaginary part square. Right? So you have a square root here. If you want to solve it, make this 200 square and you will get a quadratic equation. Okay. And how will you decide which is the correct? Whichever is closer to 200 volts. I'll get VD is 188.49. Yeah. So you'll be solving for a quadratic equation. So for a sending end voltage of 200 volts, my receiving end voltage is 188 volts. So there is a drop of around 12 volts. Clear? So I think it's now clear how to solve the problem, right? Thank you. So in this section, we saw how to specify the loads. The power factors you can specify either with respect to the receiving end or with respect to the load voltage, and how we have solved. Thank you.